So here we are once again at 66 Speed Bike. We have the cleaner with us as usual. So it's not going to be a tech talk today because my turtle has suffered some issues. It's leaking, it's old and leaking. So Ahmad, can you share with us how does this happen? Why does the fork
For your information,
leak?
I can guess this guy probably always do a wheelie or a stoppy on his bike.
No, I don't do that. Maybe you did on my bike.
Alright, to start it with, fork leaking is a common problem for all the bikes. It's not something that you can say that is gonna be not leaking for the entire life of the bike. When it's come to a time, a fork leaking will happen to your bike. But a several cause that might lead to leaks happen much faster than the other. For example, if you are a road user, a normal road user, not doing any action like stoppy or wheelie, a condition of the road can lead to a leaks to your fork much faster to the other bikes, right? If you are a cruiser that goes on a highway, long distance travel, it might not happen, but a guy who's using a bike on a condition where the road is quite bad or the area is quite bad, the road condition, maybe a twisty area or kind of this, can lead to a faster leaking to the others. Why this thing happen? You have to understand that the seal is preventing from one condition, from preventing any oil that's inside your fork to go out, right? But it's basically sealing off a dry area to a wet area. So eventually when the dry area got rubbed into your o-ring or the what we call it, the fork seal, so later on this will basically eat the surface of the seal. Eventually you will have leaks. Alright? A bike that been parked for so long on one condition like this side stand, for example, a bike that been left maybe 3 or 4 weeks, led to a deformation of the seal itself.
So you're saying that it's true that if you leave your bike on the side stand for too long, it actually will hurt the left side of the
most of the time, yes.
Fork. So
yes,
it's very common for the left side to get worn out.
In this case, it's also left side, yeah.
Yeah, left side.
Because the thing is, when you park it for some time, mm-hmm, on a side stand, mm-hmm, what happened is all the weight is been transferred to your left side of your bike. Mm-hmm. So for that, we don't say that it's gonna bend your fork that way, but it does give some stress, mm-hmm, to your left side of your fork. And that's probably what happened, is deform a bit. I'm not gonna say it's gonna deform the totally seal, mm-hmm, because the seal itself is quite strong and quite, I would say, robust or things like this, right? But the surface of the seal is basically getah lah, getah, mm-hmm, getah apa?
Getah rubber lah.
Rubber.
Come on.
Rubber.
Come
sorry.
Come on.
Lah.
Be safe. Use rubber, bro.
Rubber kan.
So anyway,
so when we open up that, yeah, due to that, when you keep it for some time, uh-huh, and you use it after that, what happened is this rubber took time to go back to this original, probably after use. Maybe you park it for some time, right? Mm-hmm. It's deformed a bit, but when you want to come back to the original shape, maybe some dust has tried to dive in. That's leading to a leak.
So you cannot seal properly. Alright, so for my case, for my records, I checked that the last time I did a fork service at 66 was 40,000 kilometers, and now it's going on to 60. It's already just past 60,000. So your recommendation is I service both sides of the fork.
It's always why? Because after a mileage on the fork, the oil does reduce, mm-hmm, the oil viscosity change, mm-hmm, the oil behavior also change. Mm-hmm. Alright, it does contain some contamination inside the oil. Mm-hmm. So if you just service one side of the fork, mm-hmm, that will give an unbalanced suspension on your fork.
I see.
So the best is always when you have more than 5,000 kilometers, just service both of them.
Service both.
A track racer, they always service the fork twice or For example, like me, every two times of a race, I service my forks to make sure I have a good quality of fork oil inside it.
Okay, so when we open up the forks later, you can show us the fork. Is it? Do you think it's going to be a visible thing to see?
We can see from here as well. That probably what has led to a leak.
Yeah, it's pretty. It looks pretty bad, right?
Sometime, I'm not sure I can. This is quite clean, to compare with others,
Clean.
This is quite clean. Okay, sometimes you can see there is some marks of scratches here.
Okay.
What happened is when we use the bike, always maintain a good, a good area or a good clean on your.
So you're saying to keep the tube clean.
Yes, you always have to keep it clean because if a small dust got basically stuck into it, and when the seal goes beyond it, that's probably have stuck between the seal.
Okay.
Right, and that's when you move it for more and more time, that's creating what we call a scratch. I can show you maybe some example. Let me find it. Okay, this one we can consider as a bad condition. You see this? Alright? So, if you feel at the back, you see, got a lot of dust. If let's say this seal pass beyond this area, you will have a leak, right? You have to always maintain your chrome at clean condition. So send it for wash or what, make sure that this is properly washed, you see, at the back side. So you have to make sure that this is clean, because any dust that get attached to this chrome later on will go and stuck between the seal and you will have leaks.
I see. Okay.
The worst thing that could happen is you will have a scratch on your things. Where is the?
Not easy
without the thing. Okay.
So right now you are removing, disassembling the forks.
Yep.
And okay, if the fork is leaking, what will be the symptoms? I mean, apart from visually looking at the leak, what would the rider be able to tell or feel? Like, is the fork unbalanced?
Okay, if you are a MotoGP rider, you can feel it straight away. If you are a rider like me, like a normal rider out there, right, you won't really feel it.
Normal rider, right.
But what you can see is most of the time you can feel when you have uneven, worn on your tire.
Okay.
That been caused by the suspension.
But that would be like a long time already, right?
That's long time. That's probably a small leaks happen. Maybe the oil level is not correct between both of the suspension or the setting on those. Both some suspension is not even. So then what you have, one side probably is hard a bit, one side is soft a bit, so it's basically eating up your tire lah.
So for this kind of case where the oil leak is quite visible, if you are not aware of it, will it affect your brakes? Will it like
it is
make
it's
your brakes
or affect your brakes?
And then how?
Then you might have an accident lah.
Yeah, that was what of my concern lah. I was worried that it will make the braking, that's why
it will affect your braking for sure.
It will slip into the brake pads, right?
Yep. So what happened is, you see the direction of the oil will go down, and you see here is pouring at your arm here. You see that?
Yeah.
You see that?
Yeah.
So
you can
eventually it will go to this side.
To the disc.
And when you apply, man, will not bring friction.
There's no braking.
Oil is anti-friction.
So you're only going to tank up one side lah?
You're only going to tank up one side.
By then you can feel like, why is it behaving?
Yeah, you will feel lah. Maybe the distance before this is 20 meters for your braking at 180 to 0.
Contract.
In normal road, 20 meters, which is 60 feet. Now it's already reduced. Maybe it will go to 100, maybe or more than that. So then you can feel it. You can straight away feel it. Oh, something wrong with my brake. Okay, first thing when you have this feeling, look if there is any oil or there is any water or whatever got caught in between or got stone or whatever chips happen, right?
So in this kind of case, recommended to service the caliper, because the fats might be...
Not really, you need to service the caliper, because the heat eventually will
get
burn
the,
up the oil.
Oil.
Yes.
Okay.
Because after you do a suspension, you have to go for a spin in a safe area and apply continuous brake.
Release.
Huh?
Have to do stoppies.
You don't need to do stoppie lah. Eventually stoppie will come lah.
I see. Okay.
But you apply continuous brake. So what happens is, it will heat up the pads. When the pad is heat up, it will basically burn up your oil or excessive oil. Best is, clean it with the anti-oil or whatever.
Brake pad cleaner.
Brake cleaner. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Chain right. cleaner or whatever. So remove the oil.
Alright.
Disassemble everything. You're gonna clean it up, replace the fork seal, put a new fork oil based on the measurement, and then we're gonna install it back to the bike. Alright? So to open this, if you look, this has a octagon. Octagon or hexagon? I don't know. La.
Some lah.
Whatever lah, it has eight parts lah.
Eight means
octagon lah. Yeah. So you need to use a special tool to basically open up. Do not use any kind of plier or whatever lah. Use this tool, put it here, and then you loose it up. All right, it's easy. But most of the time, probably the fork has been laid down for quite a couple of years or maybe months, right? It has an O-ring seal here inside that might cut it. Or what we call as a lock, tight lock or something like. So to remove this, we need to give some hammer, and the best tool to use it is a hammer gun, or what we call as a opening guns. This one, just give a couple of bumps. That's it. Done. It's loose up already. Okay. Same goes here. Alright. So now use the ratchet, move it up. Okay, ambil basket, ambil apa bekas, ambil bekas, bekasnya. Because some of the case, what we find out is when you use your hand to open up the first time, the lock is there. Or what we call as a apa dia panggil grease lock lah. Sometimes it can happen. So when you try to open with your hand, you might slip, and in the end you will damage the surface. So just use the gun to remove it or to loosen up, but not to remove the whole things, because you might have a thread which is crossed or whatever. So use your hand to feel the thread. Okay, when opening it up. So once we have done this, remove the oil to a oil pan, no contaminant, right? And then the best is to measure it to make sure we know that this is right. Okay.
Barely any oil,
I think got some lah, but it's trapped. Okay, clamp the fork on the wires. Tujuh belas, enam belas. Okay,
ambil handphone ni kat sikit, tak bawah.
So now, remove each piece properly. Place it to a container that you can basically arrange it as you open. Right, sometimes you might forget. Just arrange it as you open. Okay, pull out piece by piece, look for any damage. Alright, if you notice any damage, just replace it. And then again, try to put the oil.
$20,000, yeah. Is it the fork, the center of it is fatter than the size, is it?
Which one?
The diameter?
This side. Because you're going to grip on the body. Mm-hmm. So it has, let's say, if this thing has the same diameter, you might squeeze the things.
Oh, the components so inside.
Yeah, so they make it bigger, the OD is bigger, so then the ID is still the same. Mm-hmm. The only thing is the OD is bigger, mm-hmm, to avoid squeezing the seal here inside. Mm-hmm. It's just basics engineering, bro. Don't ask this kind of question.
Oh, sorry lah, I'm not engineer.
No, I'm not engineer as well.
Yeah, so how I know it's basic?
Oh, trying to play with E with words. Okay, remove the punya clip ring. Bawa main kecil sikit.
So the rings that you are talking about replacing will be the ones that you are digging out now?
Yep. Okay, let's remove it. So now,
play so wrong, man.
Huh?
So wrong. So it looks so wrong.
Why?
The way you're doing it.
With the face, then it's correct, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, viewer. You have to put beep sound, huh?
I don't care. I already put the viewer advisory already.
Okay. Come.
What are you doing? Oh, that's how you do it.
Yep.
Just pop it.
Huh?
Just pop it like that.
Pop it. See the muscle?
Oh. So apart from the seals that are the most common to give away, What about the internal components?
This damping white seal O-rings, this they call it strap ring, or center leaf ring. All this can give away as well. You need to replace this every time, but not every time lah. When you feel like it's no longer gripping, mm-hmm. and you can see that the marks on the body, like this one is still good, huh? Okay, when you see that it's there is a marks on the body, that means that it's keep on, that it's already worn out. So you're having a contact between this and the ID of your housing. Then you replace them.
But still the most common are the seals.
Yeah.
For the oil, last one you gave me was the heavy one.
Now this time I think I'm gonna give as per, I think manual says 10, we give you 15 last time.
I remember it's the heavy one, the one that 15. You use.
Yeah, 15. So this time maybe you can change to, I would say 5, the softer one, you can see. Yeah.
But why softer? Means you have to, the shocks will be softer.
Softer?
So after cleaning up all the parts and you need to dry them off, right?
Yes.
So everything is clean and dry.
So you can see everything is clean.
And I think there's some things you need to address. Maybe you can tell us about this.
This is, the name of this part is basically dust seal.
This is the dust seal.
So this is a dust seal. Come here, come closer here. And then I want you to zoom in until you can see that. Can you see this?
Yep.
Okay.
Correct.
So what happened? The rubber is cracked due to, of course, its edges.
Wear and tear.
All right. And your bike is already like almost what? 16 years? 2010.
9 years. Where got 9?
2010 ma.
The bike I only get where got 2000.
The production is 2009,
can? No. Year of manufacture is 2012.
Okay, 2012, so we are looking at 7 years.
So,
of course, this seal is gone already. This is rubber. Normally, if you are using a brand new bike, if you look, the seal will be pretty much intact. This is how a good seal look like.
This is brand new, right?
This is brand new. You see? Okay, the name of this part is dust seal. It basically as a it works as a wiper before your seal goes through. It's basically located like this, right? So as your fork moving down, the dust seal is basically wiping up any dust, excess dust, which is not like melekat lah. Melekat is what?
Sticking
to the chrome. Anything that can fall, it will wipe it off, and then basically, you will have pretty much clear fog that this seal will travel. But anyway, if you didn't replace, sometimes you don't need to replace because the condition is still good. But in this case, this seal considered as to be gone already lah. Yeah. Alright, so it doesn't really works as it should be.
Yeah.
So the best is to replace this dust seal. So as a user of a motorbike, give a care, look at your bike, physically look at the dust seal. You can visibly see this from your bike as it seems stand at your house or your garage. Look at it. If you find out that it's already like having a crack like this, just replace it. Alright? It doesn't cost much. In Malaysia as well, it's around 40 ringgit per piece.
Per piece?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's not that much. It's probably 10 bucks US dollar. Pretty much. Alright?
Okay.
But anyway, it does what it should does, Mitch should do. Alright? Prevent any dust to go to your dust seal and basically give a better life to your dust seal. Your fog seal. Alright. So for us to start, we have to make sure before we assemble everything, we clean every single piece. Make sure there is no oil or anything located inside this plunger. Alright, clean up all this area. Look at the visible parts. No scratches, no distortion or anything. Make sure every single part is clean up. Okay, oil it up before you assemble. And then it's just a matter of putting the pieces back together. That's all.
So for the oil, the last one I used was the heavy type.
Yep.
So for this time, we are changing it up.
To
we are
the using one factory suggested to be as a medium.
Medium.
Which is 10 weight.
10 weight.
10W.
Okay.
Right? So we're just going to use that one for this time.
Alright.
Alright. Let's assemble this.
Alright. Make sure no extra parts.
We just put it to the side. We know that it's
extra.
You know, sometimes
it's
factory,
not needed. It's
you know,
not
sometimes
needed.
Factory,
you like to give
put,
extra.
Yeah, they give extra for your weight. So if you find out there is extra screw, when you assemble an engine, you find out there is extra screw, you just throw it off. It's just excess. You know you are right. Don't take that advice, huh? Alright. So let's put this all together. And clean.
So on the chrome itself also it's good, huh?
Yes.
No scratches and
it looks good, eh? If you look, it's been properly cleaned up. Okay, there is no. I have an example of one chrome which is gone already. So this is an example of a chrome that has gone already. If you properly zoom in here, you can see that this area is out, right? So what happened? You had the leaking and keep on using the bike.
Okay.
So in the end, there is no more oil that used to lubricate this area. So instead of having a lubrication at the back of the seal, now the seal is direct contact to the
rubbed directly
and that's it, it's gone.
It's fucked up. So this one can be repaired?
No, replaced with the new one.
The whole tube?
The whole tube.
Wow.
The whole chrome tube here.
Wow. So luckily we don't have this on for the turtle.
Okay. So as a user, you have to make sure you always maintain your bike. You know, I always recommend any fluid located in your bike, no matter it is fork oil, brake oil, coolant, what else? What else we can think of?
I think anything
that you can think of.
Yeah.
Let me check the manual to make sure I'm putting it on the right place. So this one goes inside like this, right? Put the spring on and put this one in like this. Alright, put this piece in, take off this part, slide this thing, alright, ready, because we need to assemble it now, so this is, so put it on the vise. Now it has a bit of stress line. You have to push a bit before you tighten it up. Okay? So place some oil. It's normal. There's some oil. Okay. I missed a part. Where before we install this, we slide the other parts in. Later, we will have a good time of opening up everything again. Okay? So slide in the dust seal. Okay? Put some oil. So you can slide it in. Right? And then, take one of the fork seal. Right?
It's a new one. Can you tell us, is this OEM or what?
No, it's not OEM. It's aftermarket, but it has a better seal durability to compare with OEM.
Ah, okay. So what brand is this?
This Vestra. Is Vestra.
Vestra.
And the manufacturer is FTSR. I don't know what's the brand. But this is Japan material.
From Japan?
From Japan.
Uyo.
Okay. So this is how you have to put it. Seal outside like this. Inside, which is contained, the oil is like this. So just place it inside. Simple, done. Okay. Slide in the stopper. Put some oil in. Look with oil. Make sure your hand is clean. Look with oil.
Your hand clean or not?
No, I just dirt a bit. There is some.
I thought you put it hidung just now. You take your nose, you clean.
I use this one. Come on.
I thought it's a natural look.
Okay, it's like KY gel, you know.
Ooh.
Okay, slide this piece. Make sure that this properly fit. Alright, so a couple of tests you can do to make sure that it doesn't loose at all. Alright, it fit properly. Make a pressure on it to see if it's moving or not. So this is quite good. You can even push it like this to make sure it doesn't move out. Right, so okay. This is done.
The coloring on this is what?
This is like
I mean the coloring
like protective.
On this one?
Oh, the coloring I think they have run out of watercolor, so they use a gray color here lah. So they don't want to use white color.
I see.
This is a chrome. How you say?
Chemical reaction is it?
No. This batam from is originally is a stainless steel. They salut dengan chrome. How you say salut?
They chrome it.
So it's not original a chrome. Chrome is basically how they do it. They like.
It's a chemical process to put the chrome on.
On la.
Okay.
So the word is too hard for us to think at this moment.
We are not engineer. I mean, at least I'm not an engineer.
Okay. So they do chrome to the stainless steel part. So that's why you can see that this is where the chrome been place, and you don't need a chrome here.
Oh, okay.
Because you're not going to move anything here. It's going to be up to here only, the limit.
Alright? Okay.
When the fork move, it's up to here only. It doesn't move all the way up here. Alright? So then, you put this one, put back the piece that it should be.
Okay.
So now it's correct. Okay? You have put everything. Then, slightly with a small pressure, turn your screw in. Alright, so then you just screw in all the way with your hand. Easy peasy.
Lemon squeezing.
Lemon squeezing. Okay, place it all the way. I think you have to put at least 30 pounds of torque, but we use manual torque, which is my hand feel.
Wow.
Done.
Why?
Why? Yeah. Because you don't need to put too much stress on this one. It doesn't move. It doesn't. There is no moving action on this part. It's just sliding action. So you don't need to put that much of stress on it, right? You just need to hold it in place. That's it. And this is a piece of alloy. This is stainless steel, that's why it's rated very low. If it's still, of course, they will ask you to go with higher, right? So it's just small, just fill it until you don't make sure you don't really over tighten it. Okay, if you have the tool, better use the torque wrench. I don't have the big wrench here to use it. With this one, I use my hand fit. Alright, then we install this lock nut, right? Okay, we are done this part. So now, we're going to slide this housing So there is a couple things that we have to make sure. When we slide here, so what happened, we're going to have to make sure we centralize to the seal here. If not, this seal will be broken. Right? So we put oil to make sure that it is properly oiled. Put a lot of oil here. No worries. Don't be shy. Just put a lot of oil. Okay. Move it in and out. Children, don't look at this part. Alright?
Adult content.
Okay. So see. This is how we feel. There is a small of resistance. Mm-hmm. That means the O-ring is still good. At the same time, you are not damaging the ring. Alright?
Not so, like forcing it in.
Correct. So this is good. Okay?
Okay.
So to double confirm, just take it back and look. So everything is nice. Right? Mm-hmm. You can see that it is sliced. It does slide the oil all the way up if you see. Can you see that?
It's very shiny, so I'm not sure if what I'm seeing.
Okay, whatever. So look, it's very shiny. Okay? Yeah. Done. So now, okay, move all this piece to the side here. Okay? We're gonna use another piece of special glue. The measurement of this ID is basically 41, about 41 mm.
Okay.
Alright. So we're gonna use this, which is used for 41 and 40. This is the piece here. Mm-hmm. Alright. So place it here like this. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. We use the slide or we call it guide tool.
Okay.
To slide in the O-ring inside properly. Right, couple of bumps, done.
This is for the lower O-ring that you slide
the seal. Yes.
The seal.
So if you look here, can you zoom here? If you look, the seal must located the bottom part of the, there like a groove there. Can you see the groove?
Yeah.
Okay, so it should be there. Then you just slide in this, open it a bit. Alright, open it a bit and then...
That's like a stopper, is it?
Yeah, that is the stopper.
The metal thingy, right?
Yeah. To avoid your fork, if in case it loose from going out or flying out when you do wheelie.
Okay. Right. Wheelie stopper lah.
Huh?
Anti-wheelie oil leak stopper.
Okay. So, what you can do as well, what we practice as well, to put some amount of oil here. So that in case in future it doesn't rust, right? So put some oil, then just lock it there. Okay, we put the remaining part. Now we have to put this part. Okay, to put that, the best part is to do like this. You pour some oil inside, and then we put these pieces at the end. Okay, the amount that we have to put is 433 ml.
That's from the manual, is it?
Yep. I have to double confirm anyway, but I think it's 433. Because that's what I read this morning. I think it's correct. 435, 430. Just, how you say it? Make sure there is no bubble inside your oil. Keep it for some time, and the same time I will pour it. It has plus minus about 3, I think, 3 ml.
So you are putting in 433 or 435?
433.
433, alright.
More or less. What you will find sometime when you pour the oil, it will be all the way up here. Come. Right? So, to pump this one in, the best way or the best method that we use is lock this piece together. Alright? Just lock it like that. Install this. until more or less the O-ring is submerged to the body, right? Then just pump it like this. Okay, open that. You'll find that the oil is gone already. Basically, the oil is being pumped to the bottom side of your fork lah. Then we repeat until everything is been pumped inside. That the oil is raising up, right? Okay, again. One thing you have to make sure that the oil is clean. The fork oil has to be very clean. There is no dust or any sand or whatever goes to the fork. Because any dust or anything that contained inside the oil might basically make a harm to your fork.
They never invented a fork oil filter yet.
Fork oil filter? That's one thing that I can in the future. Gonna have a lot of time. Alright. For the last action, light in. So it's perfect. Nice. Okay. So we're almost done here. Okay, put it back to the white. Lock it, alright? So we still have some, if you look here, you still have oil at the top here. Alright, anyway, we just put it there. So one thing you have to make sure is when you assemble or show up a fork, is to make sure that the oil amount is correct. That is one of the most important things. Because if not, then you start having a problem where you can see you hear some noise as you are feeding the bike. It's like clicking noise, click, click noise.
What's the reason for the clicking noise?
The oil is not enough, so basically what happens is it might float. And also you have to make sure all this setting is zero. Zero, huh?
So it's all zeroed out already?
This one is already zero. Okay, then you just turn it until it stop by itself.
Okay.
Like this, see? Until it stop. So this is where we're gonna lock it now, right? Again, no need too much of stress. Just a bit of torque to the what? To the screw and nut. Just a bit. We are done. Because it's not moving, it's just an action of pulling and pressing in, right? So now we are going to connect and finish up our fork. We are done here. Raise up the housing. Okay, we are done. take this part. Okay. That's a bit. That's enough.
Hand tighten.
I always hand tight this. Because when you clamp on your handlebar, it's basically giving more grip to the track. You see, you have this mark where your handlebar is located. So it's giving more grip. You don't need really to tighten it up to... Sometimes people are using guns, you know, to tighten. I don't know what is the reason. This is just a hand tight. It's just enough. I think if you take manual as well, they will say to you to put maybe 20, if I'm not mistaken. That's
very little.
Alright, so now we just play around the fork until you feel that it's moving. It should be, okay.
Are you looking for any signs of leaking and all the...
We will see the leaking parts later when we test the fork.
Okay.
Because you have to understand, we did pour some oil here as well. Yeah. So there will be oil dripping out for time being lah, until the oil is completely dry, then only it will be in good shape lah. So pull the marker to the top part, so we have one fork done.
And then it's the exact same thing repeated for the second fork.
Correct. There's nothing special, it's the same thing. Then in the end, you just set it up to the set that we...
But the some of the forks, like they call it the separate function fork, so each fork, the component is different, is it?
On yes, this side. It has a fork like old days. I don't think because of the technologies was exist at that moment. So they have this separate function, or they call it individual fork.
Is it old technology or new?
It's old.
So why are they going back to the old technology?
Why? Because depend on what bike you are looking at.
Like the 636 new ones, I think they are separate function
okay.
forks, right?
Why? Because it's not Super Sport Aeros 600. This one is Super Sport.
Okay.
636 is more to a road use. It's not categorized as Super Sport.
So mine is a race bike. Race category.
So when it's race bike, you have to put race component on it.
Okay.
When it's a normal, let's say, going home to work bike,
okay.
or daily use bike.
Oops. So in terms of the normal type and this separate type, so which one is actually the better one?
Better, of course, this one. You have both control the same thing.
Instead of one side doing A and one side doing B.
It's all about cost, bro.
It's cheaper.
It's cheaper. That one is much cheaper.
SS separate function. SSF is cheaper.
Yes, of course. Of course, it is cheap.
Okay.
Okay, so now we're going to repeat the same thing for this one.
So we're gonna,
I'm not going to talk this time, I'm just going to do it.
It's going to be a quick one.
Again. Four.
Yeah.
Seal.
I was looking at the bottom part side. I think there's one black piece missing. What are all those black plastic bags lah?
Huh?
What are all these black plastic bags?
Oh, this is bottles.
Like body bags, man. Oh, you want to recycle or what?
This is for recycling. We're sending it to the charity center.
See, 66 feet by charity. Hi. Four, three, three. So what happens if the oils are not balanced on each side?
Then you will have different feedbacks from the fork.
Like you turn the left or on the right, you're feeling
it
different.
Might, yeah. Then your tire also will worn out.
Unevenly. Oh, serious?
Yeah. That's what you see on the individual fork. Because they have different setup. One is just the damping, the other one, one is just for the tension, the other one is just for the compression. And then it ends up unevenly on the tire.
So the solution for all the 636 guys is change your forks, all ins. Recommended by 66 feet by.
Then, nice. Let me open it up.
So what are we doing here?
We are just playing around with your things. You know, we like to play around.
So free, right?
Yes. Huh? We don't have anything to do today.
Really?
And Cyborg came over
to disturb you.
Disturb me, saying that, hey Ahmad, I want to do this. Ahmad, can you just open up my cover set so I can have a look? So we open up the cover set. We just follow what our customer want. Right?
That's good.
Our customer is always right. That's the policy that we apply here.
So the pets.
Pets looks okay. Still thick. Mileage to go. Still a lot.
65, still can tahan.
And this one, I think, is EPC, it's a nice one. It stays quite long.
This is the OEM one, sir.
OEM?
I replaced with OEM.
Oh, okay.
OEM is what I also forgot.
Nissan, original la.
Should be Nissan also.
Equipment la. Manufacturer, OEM. Nissan.
Since the caliper is Nissan.
Brembo.
Cannot be Brembo.
Nissan. Okay. Ambil terus.
Okay, so why are you spraying all that? What's that you're spraying?
I'm spraying your caliper. This is called caliper.
Yeah, what
is it? C-A-L-I-P-E-R, caliper.
One L or double L? Anyway.
This, I think it's one L.
Okay, so what are you doing actually?
Basically, we are cleaning up your caliper so that it works perfect next time. It doesn't have any problem. Honestly, I don't clean my caliper as
often as you should.
Often as I should.
But actually, how long should we do this?
Every because once in a
are,
while.
But because breaks are important, right? So
when you have time, free time, do it.
But do if it. We can't take it off ourselves, so when
no,
is the best
why time? Cannot? It's so simple. Take off these two screws, mm-hmm. remove this stopper, mm-hmm. take off your brake, the pads, place it as it should be. And you just buy one of these chain cleaner or brake cleaner or whatever. There is no need to mention the brand. Mm-hmm. You can buy any brand as long as it is a cleaning kit. Mm-hmm. Use a brush. Mm-hmm. Make sure it is soft.
Okay.
You don't use any wire brush.
Okay.
Because later if you use wire brush, you're probably going to create some
scratches.
And that's going to harm your brake pads. Use a softer one. Pour some of this spray, some of these things on, mm-hmm. and then use the brush and clean it.
Do you need to like pump the brakes to press out the piston?
No need. I don't do that things. You can do that. You can play around and then you press it back in like this. You see, once it's clean, you can press it back in like this. It doesn't bring any harm, but.
This can also check if the seals are okay, right, for the piston?
No, you can't check the piston if the seal is okay.
Cannot.
As you want to check the
or
seal is okay.
Or whether it's stuck or not, the pistons are stuck.
Yes, you can do a physical check like this lah, which is you're pressing it in. Mm-hmm. If it goes in like this one, kan?
Uh-huh.
If it goes in, then that means it's okay lah.
Uh-huh.
You press this one also, if it goes in, that's okay.
This what one? Happens if it doesn't come out after you press it in?
It will not come out.
No, after you, if you pump, then you can see whether it comes out or not.
It should come.
So that's how you check if your pistons are working
correctly.
But if the brake pad also can tell, right? If there's a
it's uneven.
Because I remember my previous one had some uneven wear.
Normally, when we change, we always do this. Due to our customer, mm-hmm. we recommend just to do a clean up. Make sure there is no dust or anything.
Mm-hmm.
Take your pad as well.
clean it up properly.
Obviously, the one, the loop that the cleaner you're using is the type that evaporates, right?
Yep.
So that it doesn't stick to the pads and give you the...
This is kind of mixed with alcohol, I think.
So it will dry off?
It will dry. See? It's dry already.
Can I use WD-40?
No, you can't. Because WD-40 won't dry.
It won't dry?
Won't. Here, this is whatever that we caught from the... See?
The pads, the pistons.
Because this pan was clean before we use it. Mm-hmm. So now you can see that this is all whatever residue that come out from the pads, everything lah.
Yeah, from the pads, the calipers,
which is considered to be cancerous lah.
Yeah.
So use glove.
Better to use glove.
I need to go to the hospital.
Yeah. I'll give you ₱1 for your tabung.
Di bawah pohon remboja yang
so here we are almost done. Putting up the tire, and you need to put back all the fairing bolts. And after that, you need to test, right?
Yep.
So if some guy comes with a top gun and do it,
a lot of people got crack here on the body. Don't have.
So what happens if it cracks? Gone lah.
Gone lah, you have to buy new one lah.
The lower part again, you have to buy the whole lower part.
The whole chrome. It come with the chrome, same thing together. About ₱2,000.
One side. Holy shit.
Yes, buddy. That's the price, buddy. One thing that I want to share happened to me this morning. A guy claiming that his bike, he's using a Z6R. He claimed that the old mechanic changed his piston to a ZX Stannard piston.
Wow. Can you do that for me?
I can. Just give me ₱25,000 and I will do it.
₱25,000? Okay. I think I can buy a Z8 with that price.
Even he was claiming that the gearbox was changed to ZX Stannard gearbox.
Wow.
I don't fucking know how they do it, bro. But this guy is making money with this method.
How's it?
For me, it's okay lah.
Okay in what sense? Okay for normal lah?
For drag, kind of weekend ride, it's okay lah. But for you, I think it's going to be a little bit hard lah.
Hard ah? Harder than last time? Remember I used the hard one?
Not really hard as last time lah, but...
So it's a bit softer than last time.
But okay. Sense of damping is probably... How to say? You have to feel it yourself and tell me lah. You are the user of this bike. For me, I can tell you based on what I like. Because the bike, now when I hit the brake, it doesn't slam. Go slow. And when I open the throttle also, it go up slow. Which is good. For me, it's good. I want that feeling.
Yeah.
I don't want it's like, when you hold it, it's like, bam.
I don't want that also.
So far, I can tell you it's good. But you have to test it yourself and let me know. Anyway, you have to test it at least for 1 or 2 weeks. Before you can tell me you want to adjust or not lah. Alright?
What's it, you want to buy?
Hey, no. Johnny. mention in front of her.
Where got? No, I kidding. Set up class. I need to go for your class, ma.
it's not slamming down lah. Because last time we already set the sack, so we didn't change your sack lah. Sack is still okay. It's nice. Mm. But anyway, if you look, for me, I will say this is with heartbreaking. You know, I have done heartbreaking behind that, so it's still okay lah. It's nice.
And the oil is because of the oil you sapu onto the...
I sapu some oil lah. But you, anyway, you have to monitor lah. You monitor for 1 or 2 days. You go back, you pour some oil, water. And then you monitor for 1 or 2 days. And then let me know lah, if still dripping, then that means something wrong lah. If not, then it's okay already. And then again, what we have done is, we have changed your fog seal. We have changed your dust seal. We also have cleaned up your racks using the chain cleaners, caliper. So pretty much we have already set up your suspension, and test the suspension as well with the braking. It's okay lah. For me, I would say it's good condition. It should be able to run on the weekend ride as well. No problem.
Okay, so the Ninja, the Turtle is all good again, huh?
So we are basically promoting to anybody wanted to test this bike. Let's go for a spin test.
What is a spin test?
sprint test.
But I'm not using my bike and not me lah. I can't sprint for shit lah, right?
So should be okay lah. Should be okay. Give it a good rider, this should make at least 220 lah.
So obviously it's not me. But the brakes you mentioned were still good.
Still a lot of life left.
Yeah, so brake pads maybe can still hold off on that. And nothing else, right? Anything else? Besides the usual big maintenance stuff. That one I think I said was 80.
Performance is still good, still okay.
Your
tensioner start to loose lah, bro.
Tensioner?
You feel lah bunyi tensioner kan, ada kan?
It has a bit of a sound there.
The tensioner I think is fucked up already. 60,000 of course we have.
So have to change the tensioner?
Tensioner and the chain. Later lah, that one is later lah.
Later lah. What's the damage? I mean, what's the impact if I don't... If I wait it out?
The noise will be huge. But the worst thing could happen if your tensioner is not working. It's no more working. Because this is the automatic tensioner. If it's not working, it's not really giving attention to your chain. It might lompat.
But to do that, you have to open up all the top and everything,
no
right?
No lah. To change tensioner is just like during next waft clearance, change the tensioner together.
Yeah, but waft clearance still long way to go, how?
What? You have done it on 40,000.
Yeah.
So the next is 30,000, from 40,000, 70,000 lah.
Which is another 10,000 away lah.
Yeah.
Can.
Stay.
Boleh lah.
Boleh.
Right.
But that time, remember you have to change the tensioner lah.
I will put it in the list of things I have to throw my money at lah.
Yeah, man, you have to pay me extra because you're asking me to sit in the freaking direct sun.
Yeah, you think I'm not standing in the sun lah. Yeah. So, okay. Right, enough bullshit. Thanks the cleaner.
Thank
thanks
Ahmad.
Thanks
Thank
66 Speed Bike. Till the next one, guys. This is Cyborg here.
Thank ride you very safe. Much for coming over and bye-bye.
Alright, ride safe and safe ride.